Hey, conscious leaders, a warm welcome to yet another episode. We've been trying for such a long time to bring this episode together, and I'm so excited to bring you the special guest. Now, as you know, that our theme for the next couple of months, I don't know how long it's going to go. I'm going with intuition here, but I really feel that we need to start focusing on building a resilient future for ourselves. And by building a resilient future, we need to bring back trust in ourselves, learning how to trust ourselves before we can trust the world at large. And more importantly, is just connecting to the essence of who we are. As we know, the world is chaotic out there, and that is why the special guest I brought to you today is Taz Singh. Taz Singh is a renowned medium. Now, I know Taz for quite some time.
Forever.
And she's a friend of mine who has helped me through such a hard time in my life and really opened up my eyes to this world that she lives with and that she swifts in and out of. But as a medium, she also gets to experience life through different dimensions. And she also encounters the chaos of the day-to-day things that you and I probably deal with. And I think, Taz, just first of all, I'm so excited to have you here. Days like this took long.
Thank you for having me.
Jeez, like, I mean, like, you've been traveling, so I've been watching, I've been trying to follow your trail. Like, every month I see that there's a retreat. Then you're in Hollywood, then you're in Las Vegas, then you're in California, and then you are in Africa, and then you're here. Like, hello, what's going on?
It is work. You know, the nice thing about my work is I get to meet people from all walks of life and from all over the world, right? And I love what you said that, you know, you're on this mission of building trust. People need to find that trust within themselves. But we also need to learn how to love ourselves.
Oh, yes.
Right? And that is the most important thing, right? Is if we do not love ourselves, how do we trust ourselves? We are so good at, sorry, I'm jumping right into this.
No.
Are so good at giving of ourselves and empowering others and motivating others. But when it comes to slowing down and focusing on ourselves, that is where we fail. We become too critical. We become too judgmental. And it doesn't matter whether I'm seeing a person in Los Angeles or Vegas or here in South Africa. We all have the same issues.
Exactly.
Right?
Exactly.
It doesn't matter whether you're an A-list celebrity or a common person like me. We all have the same difficulties, the same fears, the same anxieties. And that is what blocks us. Right. So before we even start loving and respecting others, we've got to slow down and look at ourselves. So I love that you have started with this theme and that you're going to continue with this theme for a little while because it is a very deep concept.
Yes.
It is a very deep concept. You know, a lot of people that come to me are in issues of marriage or relationship or career, but that is all external. And they start projecting. But they're not looking within that. Why am I in this toxic relationship? Why am I in a dead-end career path? They are not stopping and looking at what's going on within that I need to change, that I can attract positive. And that is also very important. In order for us to attract positive, we got to feel positive within ourselves.
I love what you're saying there because one of the things that I've been talking a lot about is this whole idea of authenticity. And authenticity for me means that you have to do the inner work, right?
100%.
You have to do the inner healing before you can really show up as yourself. But what happens is we go out into this world and we put on these masks and it becomes so, so difficult for us as human beings to attract the right things to us because we're putting something out that we're not.
But also we become so good at using the mask that we don't know who the real
is, right?
Now, I say this all the time. For me to be a healer and for me to be a life coach, I need to practice what I preach. So I have a successful business. I can talk business. I have a successful marriage. So I can talk relationship, right? I have children. I can talk about kids. So I will speak about things that I have tried and tested and that has worked for me. I cannot speak about things that I failed in. Right. Mm-hmm. And that is very important because a lot of people are seeking guidance from spiritual leaders or life coaches. But look at their background. Right. What have they excelled in? I need to go to someone that's excelled in an area that I'm seeking guidance in. Right. Than just blindly following someone that cannot make their life work for themselves, but now wants to guide me. Right. So when we speak about pausing, about reflecting, about loving, about grounding, it applies to us as a healer as well. I cannot sit and preach if I have not done the work on myself.
I totally agree with you. And, you know, something I think that is so important, and especially looking at what's going on in society. So one of the things, you know, I haven't spoken about is I do a lot of ethnography and looking at where the pulse of the emotional turmoil or the emotional joy is moving and shifting almost like online, like the Sherlock Holmes of that, and trying to read that and interpret that human behavior. And you know, what I see a lot is a lot of charlatans and a lot of mm-hmm. people that are, there's a lot of untruths that are spoken also online, which is also creating a lot of havoc because people don't know what the truth is. And now we've got AI everything and everything is augmented. And now there's an extra layer. And the only way that we're going to be able to truly know what the truth is seeking that inner wisdom mm-hmm. and really grounding ourselves to your point is where we need to get to a point where we, how can I put it, almost center ourselves.
But you know, Carmen, you know me so well. And you know I don't believe in all of this. Right? So I don't believe in I have to follow numbers to decide what my day is going to be like. I'm not going to follow stars to see what's aligned to decide what my future is going. I don't believe in this, right? I believe in myself.
Mm.
If I get up today and I feel powerful today and I'm going to work today, I'm going to work today. Mm. So no star and no number is going to tell me I'm not going to work today. Okay. Yeah. And if I feel that I get up today and I need time out and I need to rest, mm-hmm. I don't care if the numbers are aligned for me to make money, but if my energy is low, I'm going to take time out.
Yeah.
So everybody has power in themselves,
absolutely,
in their hands, in themselves to actually define their journey. So I do not like when people sit back and wait for external things to decide what your outcome is going to be. I don't get up and look at what is the star saying today. What's the number saying today? And now I'm going to plan a retreat. I'm going to plan a trip. No, I decide today, right, in a month, I'm going to go to America and I'm going to do X, Y, and Z. And I get the ball rolling because I am in control, nothing else. Right. And everybody should be living their life on that term. Because when we start giving power to external, we again allowing ourselves to be controlled.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So I hear where you're coming from and I hear all the things that you are wanting to learn. But sometimes you need to stop and say, what is my intuition saying? Because your intuition will be the most powerful, not the stars, not the numbers.
Absolutely.
Your intuition is your inner guiding force.
Yeah. It is. It's a compass. It's the map, exactly. And the map of your life. And I feel.
And what about those that don't know about the, you know, astrology and don't know about numerology? So what happens then?
Yeah.
You know, that now they are feeling all lost. No. You slow down. You trust in God. You trust in your ancestors, because I'm very big about ancestors. So you trust in your loved ones that are supporting you and guiding you. And most importantly, you trust in that inner voice. And I promise you, it will ground you and it will allow you to follow the right path. You know, sometimes we do things because the external expects that from us. You know, the world wants to see something. But are you truly happy? Right. Sometimes it's okay to choose a different path from the rest of the world and find your inner peace. Because when you have peace, you will have success.
Yeah.
Right. And when you have inner peace, you will have abundance. Right. And what do we really want? Not just money. We all want quality of life. When you have inner peace and you have grounding and you have that sense of direction, money will come to you. All right. You know, I'm talking about myself. I don't get up every day saying, I need to make X, Y, and Z. I get up every day saying, I want to make a difference.
Exactly.
Because when I make a difference, I'm doing good. And the more good you do, positive energy will come back.
Exactly. And I feel that it's so rewarding. I think for me personally, how my life used to be versus who I am today, I don't feel I can wake up feeling that I want to always just have this one objective of just doing one thing, and almost buying into a future that I'm not necessarily believing in.
But you must remember, Carmen, your personality is you're too kind, you're too loving, you're too kind. That was our issue in the beginning, trying to bring you back. You were giving of yourself to a point where you were being abused by friends, right? You went through a lot in your personal life with family, you felt abandoned and you were looking for that comfort from friends, and you allowed yourself to be manipulated, right? Mm. And you had to, I mean, we did have many conversations in the beginning, and you felt guilty, like I had to buy this and I had to give that to feel like I belong with someone. And now that you have stopped that, you have started to love you. You have started to see your vision and your plan for your life, and you're putting energy into that, right? And that's where you needed to change.
Yeah. And I think anybody can achieve that. I think it's literally is, I think when you start moving into a place where realizing that things are not happening against you, but for you, and learning that it's, that you can grow from it, right? You know what I mean? I think when you also change your mindset around that, that's also when things change.
100%. When you change your mind, you're starting to change your energy. You're starting to change your vision. And the moment your vision changes, your path changes. So from a spiritual perspective, what I'm always teaching my clients, and you know, I do a lot of retreats, and at the retreats, we're doing healing, we're doing grounding exercises, we're doing cutting of cords, we're letting go of anything that has held us back, whether it's disappointment with a family member, whether it's a relationship, whether it's a career, whatever it is, we do cutting and releasing. But most importantly, we start manifesting. Right. And manifesting is a very important concept as well. So the stages, if anybody's listening and want to know, how do I improve my life? Right. The first step is take a step back. Right. And say, right, I want to find me. We all become puppets in society. We all become part of this race. But what is the race about? Right. So you take a step back and say, I want to find me. What is it that I love? What is it that I enjoy? What is it that I want to do for my life going forward? And you start defining your purpose, right? That's one thing. The second thing is you look at all the people or all the situations that are negative. Sometimes a person may have hurt you and left, but you are stuck in that situation. Yeah. You are stuck in that emotion. The person that has hurt you has now moved on, but who is hurting? You are, right? So then we look at all the things that are negative, whether the person is in your life, whether that emotion, the person's left, but they've left behind an emotion. So we start looking at healing all of that and we release it, right? And then the final step is embracing, right? So now you know what you want. You've released the negative so you can make way for positive to come in. You can make way for energy to now be received. And now we start doing the work. Things will not fall into place if you don't do the work. But if you know what you're working towards, it gives you more passion, right? You feel alive because you know that you're going to achieve, right? So it is so important to set those goals and to start working towards it and set small goals as well, that when you tick things off, you start to feel empowered. And when anybody feels empowered, it lifts their energy. It starts to make you shine brighter. And I promise you, the more you love yourself, and the more you start doing things to honor yourself, the world starts to notice you.
Yeah, and I also think it's so true what you're saying. And I feel when that part happens, when you actually also celebrate yourself 100%. With those little victories, you see how far you've come. You know, I sometimes go through, I've got a separate computer that every now and then I go through everything. I'm like, who was she? Like, I can't believe she came up with that. Did she do that? I'm like, oh my gosh. And then I just go, good for you. And I give myself a high five.
And you should.
And you know, I feel there was a time where I completely became depressed around everything that's going on in the world. You know, you see the wars going on. You see what's going on online. And everybody's at each other the whole time. And then you've got, you know, the layers that's unfolding in your own life. Then you start doubting the efficacy of companies and corporates and governments and leadership that you really don't feel that there's hope. But the hope comes from us. And that is how we actually impact the whole world around us.
100%. So if we sit and look at the war and look at the government and look at everything as you've explained, and we start becoming despondent and we start becoming depressed, we are not going to be part of that positive change.
Yes.
Right. So in order for us to want change and to see change and feel change, we need to say, right, I'm detaching emotionally and I'm going to look at what I can do in my space, in my surrounding on a positive level that will ultimately impact positively outwardly. Right. Yeah. So that is very important, because if we get caught up in every emotion that is surrounding us in the news and everything that is negative, you are never going to play your positive role in making change
happen.
It's
so powerful. It's so powerful. And I love that, because, you know, I got into a stage where, like, these are little things that I do in my house, like lighting candles. For me, just lighting a candle is the most, it's an intentful thing that I do. Lighting incense in the house, it's an intentful thing. It's just that it just makes me feel, okay, right, I'm grounded, I'm fine. As long as I'm okay here, I know it will be okay, you know, with the world around me.
100%. But when you light that candle, immediately it changes the energy.
It does.
Because for you, it's a spiritual act. And it is about calming myself. It's about blessing my surrounding. Mm. So when you do that, it may not be the actual candle or the incense, but it's the action. When you have lit that, you know now that this is my moment of calmness.
I must tell you something funny, right? So I started going to see a homeopath, and I absolutely love her. She is amazing. And she's also a kinesiologist. And she gave me like tree bark of a peach tree and all kinds of things. And I later on say, I don't know if I'm imagining whether this remedy that you put together for me is working or not, or whether it's actually my mind and my thought patterns that are believing
it. It is your thought patterns. Because you can light a pink candle, a black candle, a gray candle. It doesn't matter what candle. But when you lit that candle, there's an intention, there's an act of calmness now that I need this moment to be about me. So it is that intention that you've set that shifts the energy, all right? Now, when we speak about the external factors, like if I take myself, I'll always use myself as an example, right? So I'm frustrated with everything happening around me, and I look at the situation and think, how do I do something positive? So now I've started working with correctional services, where I'm doing a rehabilitation program, you know, with offenders. So I'm working with murderers and rapists. I am making sure that I am giving time to rehabilitate so that when that individual is released, we are not having a person re-offend, right? Mm. So we need to look at the big picture. We're not happy with X, Y, and Z. How do we play a small role in seeing a positive change? So for me, my small role is working with offenders that are open, because it's a reading. It's, they are open because now they cannot lie. I'm telling them who they murdered and what they did.
Can't lie, no.
So now they know they are sitting with someone that sees it for what it is. So they start opening up and becoming honest. They start taking accountability. They start asking for forgiveness or telling the truth to the victim's family. So there's healing on both sides, right? The victim's family is finally getting the truth, right? To finally have closure. But more importantly, it is for that individual that when they leave prison, or even when they leave the room that they're sitting with me and they go and speak to other offenders, they're speaking positive. They're speaking about, we do not do crime. We do not do X, Y, and Z. It is about sending that message forward that we are taking away another crime off the streets. So what I'm saying is, we can sit and look at all the negatives, and we can sit and complain about everything happening around us. But what part are we playing to create change?
I love that. You know me, I'm kind of like the rebel. Like, do you remember the candles?
I do. I do.
I created these candles. They were a little bit provoking. And
I actually like them.
Taz said to me, maybe you should think of making them white. I remember that like yesterday. But I think for me, like, the activist in me is also something that I have learned to love. And I feel that it might not be for everybody, but I have to be me. And the only way...
No, but you have to be you. But what I like is that, you know, you've evolved.
Yeah.
Right? And now you're using your strength, your power, your leadership qualities on this platform to create change, to create dialogue, right? That people can come and communicate, they can express, and it is going to make a positive impact. It's going to create healing. So you have taken everything that you stood for and you looked at a platform that works for you, right? So yes, you're doing it amazingly well.
Anyway, but listen, I want to talk to you about groundedness. I think one of the things that I find, because I am a sensitive, and I know that I've got, I'm very much attuned with my my intuition, but I also know that if I don't have my emotions and I don't ground myself and I'm not intact, is that the messages that I'm receiving is conflicted. I'll give you an example. So yesterday, a very sad thing happened in our household. It was a very emotional day where our dog attacked our little puppy, who's a week in our house. She's 2 months old and playing out of nowhere. And the instinct of the dog was to attack the little puppy. And that instinct, maybe in that moment, that's what he felt, and he had to attack. But if we as human beings, if we bring it back to us as human beings, so many times we make decisions in boardrooms, we make decisions everywhere with our emotions not intact and not being grounded and not ending up making a decision that's good for all. Like our puppy is now in ICU. Mm-hmm. And I use, and this for me, just when I look at the situation, I go, it's so important. And it's strange because you and I were supposed to have this interview Friday, mm-hmm. right? And now we have it a day after this thing happened. And I thought to myself, my goodness, it just teaches me something about groundedness, that it's so easy in a moment when you are not grounded, you don't have your emotional intelligence all together, that you can make a decision that you will regret forever.
100%. But if I look now, you are comparing what happened with your dog to us humans, right? But let me use that. Let me use that and flow with that.
I'm sorry.
So if I look at Belsa attacking, I see Belsa felt threatened in his space, and Belsa felt like I needed to react. Now, when we as humans feel threatened, we also become impulsive and we react. And instead of responding, we're reacting. Right? And it is so important that whatever's happening around us, we take a step back and we reflect and we respond. Because when we react, we are impulsive. And as you rightfully said, we will make a decision that may affect our life going forward. Mm-hmm. But the moment you take, even if it's 5 minutes or an hour, and you just process what is going on, and you come back and you respond, you will respond effectively. All right? Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of us don't do that. Right. Mm. We go into that mode of, I need to protect myself. We become defensive. Right. Mm. Whether it's a boardroom or whether it's your relationship, we feel like we need to now protect ourselves. And protect yourself from what? You have not taken the time to process, to understand, because a lot of times misunderstandings create conflict. Mm. Right. So in order to make sound decisions, yes, you have to be grounded. But you also need to be able to be mature enough to remove yourself from a situation, to understand it fully so that you can respond, right? You might be in a situation where so many things are happening and you're not able to ground yourself, but you should be having that maturity to say, I'm not going to make a decision now. I will not be forced into making a decision now. It is my right to take my time to think about things.
I love that. You know, I've started implementing this rule with myself. Every time when I don't know what the answer is, I'm like, I'm going to sleep on it. I'm going to wake up tomorrow and I'm going to have that answer. Because right now I am not able to make a decision where I can look at all perspectives.
And that would be too impulsive if you did that.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah.
Only to go back, reflect and realize, but that's a mistake and it might be too late. All right. So you have a right to say, whichever situation, whether it's a boardroom situation, whatever the situation, you have a right to say, I need to think about this. Mm. Nobody can force you into a decision. And I keep using that word, do not react. Take your time and respond. Because when you respond, you will make sense.
Yeah.
And it takes away the element of misunderstanding.
Yeah, because if you actually look at what's going on, it's just a big misunderstanding. Like, like we are just not getting each other in society. Like, one thing that I think that is really reflecting, or that I've really been reflecting on a lot, is this world that looks so chaotic is actually just an inner reflection of who we are and our thoughts and our...
Yes, yeah. We're actually in a very beautiful world. It's about how we look at it. It's about perspective, right? When we talk about grounding, people feel, how do I ground? What do I do? And grounding doesn't have to be a whole big process. All you need to do is find 5 minutes in your day to still yourself.
Yeah.
Right? You light a candle. You can use that moment, 5 minutes, or even if you want to do it for an hour, you light your candle, you sit down, and you meditate, or you go into your space. Some people don't want to meditate, but it's finding a moment of quietness. Mm. Meditation doesn't have to be music and candles and an hour everything. It just needs to be 5 minutes, 10 minutes, however long you want to be, of stillness. Because when you are still, everything calms around you. Your thoughts become more clear and you are able to start working from within.
Yeah.
Right. So it's about finding just 5 minutes in your day of stillness. You know, my meditation is when I drive.
Yes.
Surprisingly, I don't listen to music in my car. I don't want to talk. I just want to be in my thoughts, in my space. And that's when I reflect. Right. Wow. So I love driving. But when I look at the energy around youngsters, and I want to bring that in, a lot of the youth now are seeking spirituality. It's like this big thing. I want to be spiritual. What is spirituality? Spirituality is not a religion. It's a way of life, right? Because everybody's like, oh, I want to be spiritual and what should I do? No, there is no way that I can say you must follow this path. Spirituality is a way of life from within. It's about being calm. It's about being respectful. It's about being honest. And it's about being kind, right? And if you can do all of that, it makes you a good human being and it taps into spirituality. And why spirituality? Because the more grounded you are with love, respect, kindness, the more those energies come through, you're opening yourself up to receiving from God. You're opening yourself up from receiving from your ancestors. You're opening yourself up from receiving information on a deeper level. Why? Because your energy is calm.
Yeah.
Right? So religion is our grounding. It's our respect. It's what we are taught and it's what we honor. Right? It is what we know. But spirituality is a way of life. It's the way we live and it's the way we conduct ourselves. So both should not be treated separately. It's one.
It is 100%. 100%. Because I mean, like, I still believe in what I believe.
You must.
And
because that's your grounding. That's your foundation.
Well, I know.
And the reason I'm saying this, because some clients come to me and they say, I want to be spiritual. I don't want to follow religion. And why? Religion is your grounding, whichever religion you follow. If you want to change, whatever you choose. But it is taking you on a path of goodness. It's taking you on a path of understanding righteousness,
yeah.
Right? So your religion is a beautiful foundation, but your spirituality is just marrying with that energy. It's a way of life. It's a way of living with decency and respect, right? So it is so important because the youth today are all, I want to be spiritual and I want to meditate. And meditation is not spiritual. You don't have to, you can follow the good without having to do things that you're not comfortable with.
100%. Right?
And finding that inner peace and that stillness will be your own method. You might find that walking gives me that calmness. Listening to music gives me calmness. Playing a certain instrument gives me a calmness. Whatever it is that you do that gives you peace, that gives you that moment of stillness, that gives you that opportunity to reflect, that is your meditation.
Yeah.
Right? So there's no one way or no right way.
Yeah, I absolutely love it. I actually have a little experiment for us today. I'm going to take it up because I think
I want to say this. This is my second time with Carmen. We were doing an interview. And the first time, I was brought into the office and you had a guest that was hiding somewhere, literally hiding somewhere. And they were brought out at the end for me to like, oh, do a reading, like testing me. So today we're doing an experiment.
I didn't even think about that. Oh my God. No, because this has changed my life, right? This has changed the way. Yes, the apple, because doctor says eat apple day, right? But I mean, this changed my life. I saw it on TikTok and I was like, I'm not sure.
I thought we were talking about apples, you know, for good nutrition, for weight loss.
This is to show you how we think. Okay, so I'm going to tell you what to do and then I'm going to tell you my story. I'm actually going to take this home. I started it this morning. So you get yourself 2 glass jars.
I want to say this to everybody. I have a crazy friend. But let's do it.
Okay, watch out. Okay. So, experiment. Do this with your children and do this with your family. Do it on yourself and see how nice you are with yourself and how your inner dialogue goes. But you take an apple and you cut it in half and then you put it in a glass jar. The one jar you're going to call the negativity jar. And in this negativity jar, you're going to say to it, no one loves you. I hate you. you're dead to me. You're never going to grow. you don't have what it takes to grow. And success does not belong to you. You will not grow. And it's all the negative things, right? And every morning you wake up and you hold it in your hands and you say those words that you've written on that jar. And then the second jar is the positivity jar. And here you go and he's going, I love you. Oh, you're so beautiful. You're going to grow into this beautiful plant. You have so much potential. You're just amazing. And you just talk with it every day. So I did this about a year and a half ago. Yeah, it's just about that time. And I thought, this is crazy.
It's actually not crazy because it's energy.
Is it? I know.
You are putting so much of negative energy into that. That apple's going to die.
Right?
But I want to tell you something. I believe, obviously, I'm a healer. So I believe in energy, right? So at my home, the main water supply that's coming into my home, I've got their love, happiness, power, success. So I've got all the positives that's coming in. So every time that we bath or we washing or whatever we're doing with water, we're getting positive into our home.
I love that. I'm going to steal that idea.
No, everybody should do it.
do it. Okay. So do you want to know what happens, right? So I did this third day. I kid you not. A plant starts growing out of the positivity jar. If we look at positivity, this is the third day, hardly any mold or anything happening. It's getting a little bit moldy there, but not too much. But what's wonderful is inside, plants started emerging out of the apple. And the seedlings are actually starting to sprout inside of the positive jar. I was like, that cannot be happening. But now I was talking to it. I wasn't doing thoughts to it. Yes. And this, I think, for me was the big awakening where I was like, oh my gosh, your thoughts have power. There was an incident that happened. I think it was like, because this experiment's like for 11 minutes. And I think it was the fifth or seventh day, something happened that was really, really hectic. And I was so angry about it. And I thought, you know what? I'm not going to disturb anybody with my energy. I'm just going to go to the jars. And I held the jars. And I left the love jar and I just grabbed the negativity jar and I held it and I didn't say what I was thinking. I said it to the apple in my thoughts. And then I said to our helper, I said, listen, I'm just going to go for a walk. I need to just clear my mind. I went for a 15-minute walk. I came back. This lid popped and it was all sweaty. It started getting sweaty all from day two. And this one still had a plant growing out, even though these interactions were happening like next to each other. And when I came back, I was saying to Cynthia, I said to her, did you pop the lid? Did you open the lid? Why did you open it? And she's like, I didn't touch it. She says, you went. And since that day, it popped every day. It couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
And I think what really made me realize in that moment is, how am I talking to myself? Am I having positive dialogues with myself, or am I having negative dialogues? And I don't care what people say. Mm. Affirmations is a great way to start.
No, affirmations is very important to start your day.
Yeah.
Right? You should be putting out positive for yourself. So it doesn't matter whether you speak the words, but it's also what you think. Your thoughts, your energy is so powerful. You can walk into a room. You could have a bad morning and walk into the room and say nothing, and people are going to feel that energy and not want to be around you. They're going to pull back. But if you center yourself and feel, right, whatever, I'm releasing it, take a deep breath in and say, right, I'm grounding myself. I'm not. You want to walk into any situation and be received.
Yeah.
You want to walk into any situation and be respected.
Mm.
Right? You don't want to walk into any room and feel like I'm bringing my baggage and our people are now pulling away. I'm repelling, right? So this is very important when we talk about centering and grounding, because it applies, especially for people that are working in high profile positions where they demand respect. You don't want people feeling that negativity, right? Mm. So, you know, when I look at people with children, now you're talking about your thoughts to the apples, right? Now imagine you are coming home with this energy. You did not go for your 30-minute walk. Mm. Now your energy is heavy. It's toxic.
Mm.
And now you've got a child that's around you that's absorbing that negativity. right? Mm. So now it's not just you that's being affected, because it affects your health, right? Now your child is being subjected to that energy. It is so important that we release before we come home. We do not bring our baggage into our house, because that creates issues with our partner, with our children. It creates negativity in the home. And that takes me to the next step, is we talk about blockages. Mm-hmm. Why do we have blockages? Why do we have hurdles in our path? It's because we are also carrying this fear, this anxiety, and this negative energy that we are not attracting what we want. Right. Mm-hmm. So it's a huge topic. And obviously, you know, I know your show has a limited time. But, you know, Carmen, today we spoke about grounding, and it is so important. But the next topic that I'd like to cover is, how do we release it, and how do we manifest it? And more importantly, how do we rise? I'm talking about work environment. How do we rise to that point of success? Because there's a lot of people that are phoning me feeling stuck in career, feeling frustrated that, you know what, I'm being overlooked. I'm not being given opportunities, right? But why? It stems from, what are you carrying? Your baggage, right? Mm. We are so good at pointing fingers that person did this and that person overlooked me. But what did I contribute? We must take accountability.
Yeah.
What am I contributing? If I'm fearful, if I'm lacking in confidence, if I'm letting all of my anxiety shine through, I'm not showing the other person that I'm ready for the next step.
100%. Preach, preach, preach. Okay, we'll have you back when you have time, because I know you're always on the go. I mean, there's readings and there's big, massive things always happening. All right, so do this exercise. I promise you, you will not regret it. Taz, I want to say to you, I love you so much. And I want to thank you for offering us time and sharing this knowledge and wisdom. And I've always had such a huge respect for you and taking the time to invest in your gift so that you can help so many lives, because I can tell you out of my own personal life that you have done so much in my life. And it was in the beginning, I had this guilt, and how you unguilted me, if I can, that's maybe a word that doesn't exist but it is so important that we don't bring guilt with us, because you're never going to grow from guilt.
It's very important you said that. You know, when we release, whether it's people or situation, whatever the negative is, the natural emotion is guilt. You feel guilty because you are a loving person. You feel bad. But if you don't release, and if you don't take back your power, you are never going to flourish, and you're never going to grow to be the person or live your purpose, right? Mm. So the guilt is another heavy emotion that you need to release. Now, I want to take what you've just said to your guests to say, go and do this exercise. And I'm actually telling them, do something different now.
I'm saying another to, one?
yes. I'm saying to everybody that's watching this, make sure you get up every day and you visualize your home surrounded in white light, surrounded with love, and surrounded with positive energy. Mm. Before you leave your house, visualize yourself. It takes 1 second to just visualize yourself in a white light or a golden light, and you are filled with love and positive energy. And I promise you, when you leave your house and whoever you encounter, they will be attracted to you. It will open doors. It will open opportunities for you. It takes a second to visualize positive. But it can take your whole hour to complain and moan and groan and put negative out.
Exactly. Listen, I'm going to try and overlay it over this. I once did that, right? I'm going to explain it very, very quickly, because I know you got to go. My husband and I, we went away to Mechalis. And before we went, I started building up this feeling that there's so much around me. Like, I don't know how to explain it to you. I think this is what you go through all the time. It's like there's something else in other dimensions that's around me.
Yes.
And it started with where I couldn't breathe. It started like probably twice a day. Closer the time was coming for us to go to this place, the closer I would call them panic attacks, got. By the time we arrived, when we were 40 minutes away, it was 5 minutes apart, like this. By the
you
time
you speak like a woman that's about to give birth.
I promise. It was the most hectic thing. And then as I arrived there, I said to my husband, I said, I have to go to the river. I have to go and meditate and just go and envision light around me. Mm-hmm. And I was I just literally had to lift my hands up and just release the air.
Yes.
And I had an inner dialogue and I said, whoever is around me or whatever energy is around me, I don't know what it is, you're free to go. I'm here to be on a break and to have a wonderful holiday. And I envisioned a silver blue light covering me. And Coleman was standing behind me and he took a picture. And this picture, you just see the blue light all around me. It's the most, it's every time I look and you can see a little, I said, that's Archangel Michael. Because you can see the, it's just the most incredible thing. And you know what? It stopped immediately.
But what does that show? You had the power to change the outcome.
Exactly.
Otherwise, you would have been on holiday, miserable and feeling anxious the whole time.
Yeah.
Right? But again, I want to end with that.
We're going to end with that?
We're going to end with that.
Otherwise, we'll never stop.
We will never stop because two friends together.
This is like, where's a cup of tea, love? Anyway.
But to end on a positive, everybody that's listening, you have the power to define your path. Take back your power.
Bye-bye now.